got big goggles blues. Big goggles blues. Can't get enough booze. Look of you's got big goggles blues. Some beer goggles reviews with me, Terry Kay, and we are in sunny Norfolk once again, and we're down at the Northcote Brewery. Almost, I see, I'm a little bit disappointed because I was expecting dancing girls, and party acts and everything else, because you just had your first birthday, didn't you?
Yeah, October's
our. By the way, sorry, this is Adam, by the way.
October's our anniversary. So October kind of represents when we had our first commercial beer, which was this time last year.
And that was the Cow Tower.
Yeah, up winter.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, it's kind of
very popular around the area as well.
Oh yeah, yeah. People seem to like it.
Yeah.
We like it.
Yeah. Cool. So I mean, you've been just 1 year going with the, you know, brewing and everything. With the lovely Captain Nemo. I love these Captain Nemo tanks and everything else.
Yeah, these, I bought these in especially.
Expecting someone with gills to come up behind me, right? But, so you've been going for a year.
Yeah.
And you've already had a little bit of success with certain beers.
Yeah, we brew one called Jiggle Juice, which is our IPA.
Yeah.
And that's won an award for Strong Ale in the bottle in East Anglia. We've had a little award from the North Norfolk Beer Festival for our Sunshine Jiggle.
Brilliant.
It was on its first outing, first brew that we did of it, won a little award.
Yeah.
So yeah, we're getting that.
So the Jiggle Juice, that's the one with the citra?
That's got citra in it, yes.
My new favourite hop there.
It's very popular.
Yeah, I do love it.
There's lots of beers with it in it, but
yeah.
I can't get hold of it.
Really?
Yeah, short supply now.
Oh.
Yeah. So they want a short supply of citra spiked beers. We're alright, we've got
it. Did you ever think about, say, like Amarillo? Or is that kind of a bit old?
We use Amarillo in other beers.
You do, yeah.
We do like Amarillo a lot.
Yeah.
But we want that nose of tropical citra.
Yeah. It's more chewy.
Yeah, it is.
That's just kind of how my mind works on it. It's more chewy. So, Adam, what have you got going so far here at the moment?
Today?
Yeah.
Today we're brewing up the second ever batch of our best bitter that we do.
Second ever,
yeah. Brilliant. It's called Bishy, Barnaby. It's a Norfolk name for a ladybird.
Yeah.
It's going right.
Bishy, Barnaby,
yeah.
It sounds at least a little bit more like how the ladybird is. He's an armoured little sun there, you know.
Yeah. There's a few different... There's quite a debate on how to spell it.
Yeah.
We've kind of gone to point spelling, so that's what we're using.
Or whether it's with the E-I, E-Y, or...
Yeah, or double E, as it be.
Yeah.
We've got the golden beer, the golden spire in here fermenting away. I brewed that yesterday. We're doing another brew on Friday, a couple of days away, where that's a whole new brew that I've never brewed before. It'll probably be a one-off, but we'll see. We're doing it with in collaboration with a local business.
Brilliant.
Another local drinks business.
Yeah.
And we'll see how it goes. That'd be good.
So what can you tell us about what's this one, Golden Spire?
This is the Golden Spire. So this is the second ever beer that we've produced. So 4.5% easy drinking, golden ale.
Yeah.
We've changed it actually, we've just tweaked it.
Yeah.
Just to kind of revamp it a little bit.
Lovely.
Just as the past year's gone by, we've learned new things, and we do things a little bit differently to how we started doing things and how this was brewed on first.
Yeah.
So we've now changed the beer more to suit how we brew it.
Would you say it is a kind of growing process?
Oh yeah.
Brewing it's further tweaking.
Well, yeah, and even from tiny little things, we'll tweak the water each season. To reflect the makeup of what's in the water that comes out of the tap.
Really?
Yeah, we'll get that sent off and they'll come back with a report for us and we'll tweak it again. to try and keep the water, at least that one thing we can try and keep stable.
Yeah.
You know, malts change year on year,
yeah.
Season on season, so we have to allow for things like that and change the recipes to just to tweak things so they're all as consistent as possible.
Yeah.
But when we want to tweak things to make a change, you know, we have to do that consciously. And yeah, yesterday we did that.
But you get your malts you get locally.
Yeah, we use two different people. We use Bramhill Farm, which are north Norfolk, about 30 miles from here.
Yeah.
And one of the best areas in the country for growing barley.
Yeah.
We also use Simpson's malt, which we collect down from Tivetshaw, their plant.
Yeah.
And they're one of the biggest maltsters in the country. And we were doing a farmer's market in the middle of Norwich one day. And the production manager, we didn't know he was a production manager, but this chap came up with a Simpsons malt t-shirt on and started talking to us about beer and malts and things. And we kind of asked him a few questions. It turned out he was the Simpsons production manager, and he invited us down, and we had a brand and all this kind of stuff. You know, lovely fella.
Yeah.
And the malt, we find, is bloody brilliant. Really
right.
Good.
Yeah.
We've used other malts before, but that one in particular, we really do like.
And it does reflect in the beers in it, you know, the good ingredients. It's the same as cooking. I mean, for all you people out there listening, you know, it is the same as cooking. If you put crap ingredients in, then you're gonna get a crap beer, more or less.
There's no two ways about it.
Yeah.
That's what we rely on. You know, rely on good water, good grain, good hops.
And I think that's why in just the space of 1 year, you're going from strength to strength already.
Yeah, it's been a massive learning process. You know, up until 4 or 5 months ago, for me and the wife, we were doing it evenings and weekends, and that was it. And we had full-time jobs on top of that. So decision was made, kind of May time, that I would give up my full-time job and do this full-time.
So what was you both doing?
I was a project manager for an oil and gas company down in Great Yarmouth.
Oh, right, yeah.
And Jen was working freelance offshore for an oil and gas company as well.
Cool.
Now she works from home.
And Jen's a geophysicist.
She's a geophysicist by trade, yeah. Yeah, and I'm an engineer by trade. it works out all right.
Yeah. Does any of that ever come in handy?
Oh, God, yeah.
Really?
Two chillers we've got there. What they do, these are jackets on the outside of our fermenters.
Yeah.
So they help chill the beer down, lots of big brew.
Yeah.
And they also, at the end of the ferment, we chill the beer all the way down, ready to rack, and it drops all the crap out of the beer, it becomes a bit clearer, it helps that process.
Yeah.
One of those was broken down the other day, so I was stuck with, you know, a copper full of beer that I couldn't chill, so I had to kind of, that's when the engineering comes in, I guess, and just fix it.
Oh, brilliant stuff.
It's broken again now. So it was a temporary fix.
That's good.
No.
So it was the sellotape that gave the game away.
Yeah, sellotape. Now it's duct tape. Engineering's duct tape.
Oh, is it? I mean, I used to be a computer cabler in, you know, one of my many millions of different jobs. And a lot of that was put together with a bit of like insulating tape and things like that. I'd be only listening anyone that I've done work for, you know. DVLA would be on the phone. You know. All our systems gone down. we're just mashed in next to the camera. I'm not pointing at you. Just mashed in there and gone through. We're now in the copper.
So yeah,
we're bubbling. So
the mash started at about 7. It's now 10:05.
Yeah.
But the mash started at about 7. And the sparge ended. I can't remember what time it ended now. Had the runoff through the underback, popped into the copper. Copper's full, boiling away, overboiling, and boiling over rather.
Yeah.
So the clock is now on, and I'll be weighing out hops in about 5 minutes, ready for the first edition.
Just punch me in the stomach, and I'll be straight out of the way. Just very quickly, what malts did we have in here?
So in that one today, we've got Maris, the majority Maris.
Yeah.
We've got a bit of Crystal and a bit of Amber.
Lovely.
We want in this
beer. A bit of wheat as well.
And a bit of wheat, sorry, as well. A bit of wheat for the head and the feel of it. A bit of Amber to give that, to give more of a reddish hue than a copperish hue, and a bit of crystal for a bit of body and a bit more colour.
A little bit of that sweetness.
Because
I love the crystal more than a bit of, you know. I can sit and eat them. Little sweeties. Break my teeth on them. But yes, right, well, thanks very much, Adam, for having us down here and having a little look. We'll be back in just a little bit when I'm going to do a cut and splice and see what else we've got going on. When Adam starts adding ops and whatever else he's going to do. And we'll talk about that then. Back again. Well, how long later then? We've had one lot in.
This must be, this is
50
minutes
left. About 50 minutes later than you last seen. We've had one lot in. And we're talking, what hop was that?
This is Brewer's Gold.
That's Brewer's Gold. And this is a single hop beer, so that's going in at three stages, I believe. Three stages. I would like to have a little, I don't know if I would be allowed, but can I just have a little film? As it happens, I'm going to show them one of the more full ones. There's what we're talking there. Look at that lovely little sodusy light, eh? And you've got, just in here, if you can see, right in there where that little yellow gland is, gland I should say, the lubricant oils and things coming out of there will be flavouring this up beautifully. They smell beautiful, absolutely beautiful. But apparently they will change character in the brew.
Depending on when you add hop into the boil.
Yeah.
So we lay on the boil here now. So these go in for aroma.
Yeah.
The earlier you add them in, the more bitterness you get out of them.
Yeah.
So I've had a bitter.
Maybe like a hot cup of tea left to stand or whatever.
Yeah. I mean, you'll get the same things out of these. You'll get the tannins and stuff just like you get out of, tea bag left to stew. Or, a young wine has a lot of tannins in that kind of thing. You'll get the same thing out of hops. So like I say, we've had the early bittering hop addition early on in the boil to provide the bitterness background to it. And this is the aroma hop, which is going in.
So is this the last one?
This is the last one.
Okay.
This is going in for the nose.
Lovely.
So because this is the best, we like our beers to be reasonably hoppy.
Yeah.
We don't like overly hoppy beers. There's a few beers around now that because the style, a lot of the style of the old bone is hoppiness. But there's some brewers around that can't take it to the end of the stream and actually over hopping things.
Yeah.
And by that ruin, we've wasted lots of hops. They're not doing any more beer.
Yeah. Do you know, the more you're talking about it, it's the more I want to marry you. You nearly got. And you're in a position, I could get down on my knee. I'm sitting here kind of going all dreamy, hiding that,
Just when Jen, the wife, she went on, she went on the brewing course, and she was away for 3 or 4 days at the time.
Yeah.
And she came back, and she said, I said, oh, so, tell us about what beer's going to do. I said, well, she says, I know the brew, from scratch now, and I said, it should be good. She said, not only can I brew, she said, but I can also brew the beer, it won't give you a hangover.
Oh, wow.
So,
I was going to say, that was when you got there and you proposed, but no.
So, it's back on the board.
Fantastic.
This is where we condition all our bottles. When we do a bottling run, we need to secondary ferment inside the bottles. So as you see, it's at a state at the moment, but we've been busy.
No, it's looking lovely. It's looking very lovely.
So,
and this is just above where all the heat is down there.
So up here
it's
probably, what's the temperature sound
that over
there?
That says 26 maybe.
25, so the bottles, normally they'll condition up here for at least a week.
Yep.
And they'll be like that. So I get a good.
So that's the secondary fermentation.
In the bottle. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm leading right off here.
All the beers are conditioned in the bottle.
Fantastic.
No pasteurisation, nothing like that.
Do you have to add a little extra bit of yeast in there, or?
We get away with it. I normally bottle as close as I can to brewing.
Yep.
So I normally do. I normally split the brew for the fermenter, some for bottling, some for going into pubs and things.
Yeah.
So that way, you get the best of everything. You get a good condition here. Plus, it's easy for me to adjust to put it to the pubs, put the ice in the baskets.
Fantastic. Yeah.
And it gives them really good condition on it, you know.
I'm so upset that you've got. I mean, I'm going to be left on my own up here. He's going down the brewery. But I'm so upset that I didn't have a what do you call it, bottle opener in my pocket, because they would have been. Hey, what?
But this, I'll start here for at least a week.
Yep.
To condition.
About the same time as I'm going to be up here as well.
But after that time, we kind of find that things settle down. You know, I don't want to be up here too long whilst it's warm, because then. The shelf life of them is shortened drastically.
Yeah.
And they you know, you just lose the gas and they get flat and a bit dull.
Yeah.
So a week up here and they'll move them down.
So it is a defined science, the amount of time that they spend in. Mean,
you can get away with it, but yeah. It doesn't produce such a good product at the end.
Yeah.
That's the tricky part. You
know? Yeah.
When we first started out, it's all a bit of suck it and see, because and through the winter it'll be the same up here.
Yeah.
Because it'll be freezing cold in here. But still with the heat coming off the brewery and filling up here, it still puts that condition on it, you know?
Fantastic stuff. It's just putting into the fermenter. I've kind of been keeping him away from the job, so it's going to be turning on the cold tap and cooling that down so that it's ready for the at the right temperature for the yeast to go in there with it. And then we're going to be fermenting. Be when all those lovely little yeast will turn into alcohol, turn the sugar into alcohol. Just going to move along here. That was where the you can still see there's the barley and the wheat in there, little small amount of wheat. Because what I thought was fantastic was Adam was just telling me a minute ago that it also likes to design into the beers that when you're drinking it, it leaves that little collar down the pint as you're drinking it. I say that little collar because usually I only get one of them collars down my pint. But usually, like, you know, them little Vickers collars on the way down the pint. And that's kind of nice. It's that wheaty kind of mouthfeel and the silky heads that you get on the beers. There's just enough wheat in there to do that. And then he's got Marisotta, I think it was caramel he said as well.
Crystal,
yeah.
An amber.
Oh, an amber, yeah, there you go. I love the look of these, coppers and fermenters and everything. They really do look absolutely splendid. So beautiful. It's what I like about going into different breweries. Some have got so much character in them, you know. These look like something that, you know, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, little Captain Nemo jobs and that, you know. And that's Adam in his sexy shorts, you know, doing. I'm going to get engaged, I'm telling you.
You've already proposed to me,
right? I've proposed once. I'm going to get engaged, I don't care. We are here once again with our gorgeous, sexy Adam there. And he's mud wrestling in the mash tun. He's up to his sexy short knees, in his short, fat, hairy knees. Sorry. In Bali, and he's really looking attractive now. I'm telling you, he really is. He's getting very worried because he's got a shovel firmly in his hands ready. listen, just before we do finish off, we've got the what's the heat exchanger down here?
Yeah. So this is the last part before the fermentation starts off. It's coming out of the drained out of the copper through the underback again, and it goes through what's called a heat exchanger, a series of plates where the hot wort is passed in one direction, cool water is passed in the other direction, that it rapidly cools the wort down.
To what temperature do you need that?
I'll be going into there. I want that to end up between 25 and 30 degrees, ideally. That's the kind of good temperature to pitch my yeast onto.
Fantastic. Yeah.
Anything lower than that is still fine, but it means I have to tinker with equalising yeast temperature to the beer temperature a bit more.
Yeah.
It takes about half an hour at the end of the day, which is a bit poor, though, but that's just how it goes. Too high, and it takes a long time, a lot of energy, to cool it down through the jacket on the fermenter. It's much easier, much more cost-effective to do it like this.
Yeah.
The water that goes, the cool water that goes through, gets warmed up, obviously, in heat exchange to about 50 degrees.
Yeah.
Gets recycled as well.
Yep.
Goes straight back in the hot liquor tank, ready for the next brew, so I haven't got to heat it up as much. I kind of laugh at people like Adams, for instance. They do their green beer, which I think uses either 2.7 or 3.7 pints of water.
Less glass and all that, yeah.
I think I average about 1.8.
Oh, you're blimey, yeah.
So, you know, not a solar panel in sight, mind.
Yeah.
And I don't reuse my green water. I didn't reuse that water. But it just goes to show that you can be as efficient if you want.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just takes a bit more effort to do it.
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah.
Fantastic stuff.
So, officially greener than Adams.
I didn't say that.
Oh, and better, of course.
And better, yeah, much tastier. Right, yeah. I haven't even tasted it yet, but I will let you know. I will let you know.
That's the last process from there. The final bit, which I'll do once the fermenter's full of work, is to pitch the yeast onto it. I'll prepare the yeast first. It takes about half an hour to do it, to liven it up, get it going again.
So that yeast sounds a little bit finicky.
It is.
Yeah.
It's like you said earlier on, you know, you feel like you're a butler to your yeast. Everything's got to be right.
Yeah.
It has to be the right temperature, the right acidity, the right amounts of...
like bathing a baby or something, you know.
Yeah. It is. And if that's not right and it doesn't ferment very well or not at all, half doesn't, that's the whole day, all the expensive food, all this barley.
Boxes. Yeah.
So it has to be right.
Adam, thank you very much for having us here today. I really mean that from the bottom of my heart, mate. Thank you for posing in there with, you know, looking very sexy in your shorts.
I'm not getting out today.
And by the way, will you marry me?
No thanks.
This has been Terry Kay for Beer Goggles Reviews with the wonderful Adam at the Northcote Brewery in Norfolk. And Brewing, what was we brewing, by the way? Sorry.
We were brewing Bishop Barnaby.
Bishop Barnaby, that's the one with little ladybirds on it.
Yeah.
And that's the Norfolk kind of slang term for the ladybird. Okay. I actually like that better because he sounds a little bit tougher, you know.
Yeah.
He's an armour-plated little tough man and that, you know. I like that.
Well, I'll show you through to the shop in a minute so we can have a go at some beers.
Oh, that sounds nice. Well, thank you very much, Adam, for having us. And this has been me, Terry Kay for Beer Goggles. Did you get dizzy then? Me, Terry Kay for Beer Goggles Reviews, enjoying a lovely day here at Northcote Brewery. Okay, cheers, bye.